There is a silent crisis in America. The life expectancy for American men is 6 years shorter than for American women. But it's even worse for most men of color. Compared to non-Hispanic white men, life expectancy is 5 years shorter for Latino men, 7 years shorter for African American men, and 8 years shorter for American Indian men. The health status of Asian American, Native Hawaiian, and Pacific Islander men is better on average than for Americans overall. But that overall figure masks disparities for various Asian American and Pacific Islander subgroups. Similarly, whatever their race or ethnicity, men with less education and economic resources also have lower life expectancy than men overall. There are many gaps in our understanding of how to eliminate these disparities and a real need for effective intervention strategies. Hello and welcome to the 14th Annual Summer Public Health Research Video Conference on Minority Health, Men's Health Disparities, Implications for Research and Intervention. I'm Stephanie Crayton, moderator for today's broadcast. Thank you so much for joining us. We also want to thank our two patron sponsors, the Institute for Public Health at North Carolina A&T State University, and the Dean's Office of the UNC School of Public Health. This program is also supported by an educational donation provided by Amgen and by generous support from UNC Diversity and Multicultural Affairs, the University of North Carolina General Administration, Counseling and Wellness Services at UNC Campus Health Services, and 25 additional co-sponsors whose names will be listed at the end of the broadcast. We could not do this without your support, so thank you. There will be two parts to our session today. During the first hour, four leading health disparities experts will carefully examine different aspects of the topic, men's health disparities, implications for research and intervention. Then we'll take a brief break and come back with all of our presenters ready to respond to your thoughts and your questions. Before I introduce our guests, a little history. The Minority Health Project was created in 1994 by three faculty members in the University of North Carolina School of Public Health. Doctors Dorothy Brown, Lloyd Edwards, and Trude Bennett, in collaboration with Audrey Burwell, who directed the Minority Statistics Grants Program of the CDC National Center for Health Statistics, the project's original sponsor. Dr. Brown now directs the Institute for Public Health at North Carolina Agricultural and Technical State University, which is co-presenting this year's video conference, along with the Minority Health Project and UNC's Office of Diversity and Multicultural Affairs. Dr. Bennett is in the studio audience today. Thank you so much for being with us, Dr. Bennett. We are broadcasting this 14th annual video conference live from the Tate Turner Carrault Auditorium at the University of North Carolina School of Social Work. The School of Social Work was home to UNC's first African-American faculty member, Hortense McClinton, and UNC's first African-American dean, John Turner. Dr. Audrey Johnson, who passed away 2 years ago, she was a longtime social work faculty member. She was also a founding member of the National Association of Black Social Workers and an enthusiastic supporter of this annual video conference. There are many factors that influence health and health disparities. Hazardous working conditions put many men at risk. For other men, being a man means not asking for help and avoiding any admission of weakness or dependency. Men, especially men of color, are also less likely to see a doctor, have regular source of health care, have health insurance, as well as take time off of work to actually get health care. Research has begun to explore how the socio-political environment affects health. Former Surgeon General David Satcher writes, quote, "We need to create an environment that fosters health and well-being, not just for men of color, but for all Americans." In that spirit, Our first presenter will actually describe to us a comprehensive approach to reducing disparities that has been developed in Maryland. Dr. Claudia Baquet is professor and associate dean for policy and planning at the University of Maryland School of Medicine. Dr. Baquet also serves as director of the Maryland Area Health Education Center program. She is director of the Center for Health Policy and Health Services Research and director of the Center for Health Disparities. She also serves as an advocate for better health care, including issues relating to the health needs and models for underserved communities. Thank you so much for being with us. Former Surgeon General Satcher also said, quote, mental health is an essential and inseparable part of health, end quote. And yet mental health disorders and frequently associated alcohol and drug abuse receive relatively little attention and resources. Men's ability to seek care for these disorders is further complicated by limited access and the idea that strong men don't acknowledge mental or emotional distress. We're therefore particularly fortunate to have with us Dr. Spero Manson. He is going to talk about telepsychiatry and other innovative treatment methods for mental disorders. As a medical anthropologist and professor of psychiatry, Dr. Manson heads the American Indian and Alaska Native programs at the University of Colorado at Denver, as well as the Health Sciences Center. He has published nearly 200 articles on the assessment, epidemiology, treatment, and prevention of physical, alcohol, drug, and mental health problems within American Indian populations. Thank you for joining us, Dr. Manson. Unstable employment without job security or benefits often exposes men to stress, hazards, and abuse. Dr. Abel Valenzuela, Jr. from the University of California, Los Angeles, has spent the last 10 years studying a particularly vulnerable and rarely studied population, men who make a living as day laborers. Professor Valenzuela directs the UCLA Center for the Study of Urban Poverty and holds joint appointments in the Department of Urban Planning and the Cesar E. Chavez Department for Chicano-Chicano Studies. His work, which he has published in numerous articles and books, focuses on three key interrelated areas: immigration and labor markets, poverty and inequality, and immigrant settlement patterns. Thank you so much for being here, Dr. Valenzuela. And finally, we welcome Dr. Frank Wong, who will give us his insights into a very understudied area of men's health: HIV/AIDS in Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders. Dr. Wong is an associate professor in the Department of International Health at the School of Nursing and Health Studies at Georgetown University. His current research interests include alcohol, tobacco, and other drug abuse, Asian American and Pacific Islander health, community-based health prevention, intervention and treatment, global health, migration, and sex role socialization and sexuality. Please join me in welcoming Dr. Wong and each of our guests today. After we hear from our four experts, we also want to hear from you, our participants, both here at the Tate Turner Kuralt Auditorium and those of you watching via satellite and over the internet. You will all have an opportunity to make your comments and ask questions by calling 1-877-869-7811 or by submitting the web form at www.minority.unc.edu/questions and by sending email to questions@unc.edu. And in order to take in as many questions as we possibly can, we ask you to keep your comments and your questions clear, concise, to the point, and shorter than 1 minute. Cancer, it's becoming the leading cause of death, and solutions to the unequal burden of cancer in minority and underserved communities require scientific advances, community education, training, and application of innovative research models and technologies. Dr. Claudia Baquet will tell us about a comprehensive education, early detection, and treatment initiative grounded in a socio-ecological conceptual framework and aimed at reducing prostate cancer in rural and uninsured men, particularly African Americans. African American men having the highest prostate cancer death rate in the world. Dr. Baquet.
Thank you very much. Before I start, I'd like to congratulate the team that has put this outstanding program together and has maintained it over the 14 years. A special thank you to Dr. Dorothy Brown, my colleague and friend who extended the invitation, and Dr. Vic Schoenbach for making it happen. I'd like to encourage the members of the audience here, as well as those on at videoconference, to please use access to the PowerPoint for having more details about my presentation, in that time is very limited. And despite being very passionate about the topic, I'm sure I'll get the hook if I go over the 15 minutes. This pilot prostate cancer program is a model for policy research and its relationship to health disparities. Very briefly, and in the larger presentation in your packets, I'll discuss the role of policy research and advocacy in fostering sustainability and community engagement in solving a very complex, serious health disparities issue. Further, in Maryland, our model for comprehensive addressing health disparities includes disparities research across the continuum, significantly engaging the community and fostering public trust, assuring diversity in clinical research participation and policy research. And finally, this very unique community-driven and initiated prostate cancer program, again, is vetted in a socio-ecological framework where multiple areas and levels of society are engaged. You're all well aware of the increasing attention to the term health disparities. Although it is largely a U.S. term, countries outside the U.S. use inequities and inequalities in health. Health disparities is a national, at least the elimination of them, is a national concern by the federal government. The increasing concern is related to the fact that our communities and patients are becoming much more diverse. There's increasing documentation on the role of culture, race, ethnicity, and nationality on health access and outcomes. Our population is getting older. And of course, we're always hearing about not only the uninsured, but those who are underinsured. For example, lose their insurance once a catastrophic illness, such as cancer, happens. And of course, literacy and language barriers are a major factor. Health disparities research as a term is evolving. It's multi and interdisciplinary. It involves research across the continuum to characterize or define what the disparities are, to explain them, to intervene upon them, and then to translate and apply those research results for community and clinical benefit, and then finally to foster policies. The historical timeline for addressing cancer health disparities has many points. A few of the highlights include the 1974 LaSalle-LaFall-Ulrich-Henschke paper that first noted the alarming higher death rate in African Americans or blacks. These were followed by the federal government's response to what is now called disparities with the Heckler-Malone Task Force and a series of National Cancer Institute responsive programs. Maryland is a state of 24 jurisdictions, 23 counties, and Baltimore City. This map simply represents an overview of rural Maryland. Maryland often is not thought of as rural. Again, it's about 5.9 million population. The largest racial ethnic minority group is blacks or African Americans, which represent 39% of the population. This is followed by Asians, 4%, Latino, Hispanics, and then Native American, both indigenous tribes and tribes that have migrated to the area. I bring your attention to this map. The bluer the area, the more percent rural it is. In Charles County in southern Maryland, it's about 34% of the area is considered rural, and that's the focus of our pilot prostate program. At the medical school, we develop a research to policy model. It's been enabled partly by our tobacco settlement or cigarette restitution fund program, which the governor at the time decided we would have a task force to define how those funds would be spent. And indeed, we're very fortunate to have ongoing support through the tobacco settlement to do some of these creative programs. Our comprehensive health disparities approach includes building community capacity and infrastructure. This is usually in the format of local outreach offices spread across the state and video conferencing or telehealth programs. Our partnerships are based in mutual benefit and trust and shared governance between community-based organizations, historically black colleges and universities, local healthcare professionals, faith-based, federally qualified health centers, and of course, local health departments. All our programs are data and evidence guided, and the disparities research crosses the continuum from the laboratory to human studies or clinical trials to practice or health services research and then policy. And of course, science guided policy and advocacy to promote leveraging and sustainability is a part of all of our programs. I put this pie chart up to basically show you that about a $68 million grant portfolio, that $17 million of those dollars have gone directly into the hands of community organizations to participate to enhance their capacity to conduct health disparities research and policy change. So $17 million has gone directly to communities' hands. This map represents the state of Maryland's counties. This is our signature community-based capacity enhancement program called the Statewide Health Network, which again is comprised of the stars, which are our outreach offices, and the little squares, which are a series of video conferencing equipment to do meetings, plan research, look at data, et cetera. Our disparities program reach is very broad. It includes health ministries such as parish nurses, a University of Maryland mini medical school where the community attends medical school for 4 to 6 weeks. They're in some of the mini med, most of them are in English, some are in Spanish. And it's a way to demystify complex concepts of health and destigmatize research in communities. Communities also take human subjects training and HIPAA training and are able to understand why clinical trials and diverse population participation is important. Part of our program is to take what the community brings to us to their practicing healthcare professionals, so we do extensive continuing education. We have a mobile asthma specialty unit called the Breathmobile to change asthma outcomes, which I don't have time to talk about, and sister circles for health improvement for older African American women. Our research and policy initiatives span several years and many pieces of legislation, which I can't talk about today. But I've highlighted our patient navigation research program, which the community brought to us as a need, using community health workers to deliver educational interventions. The pilot prostate cancer program I'll discuss in a moment was sponsored by the lead sponsor, Senator Thomas Mack Middleton, who is from Charles County, that rural community on that map, and is a former tobacco farmer. He led the charge for crop conversion money so the tobacco farmers would grow other crops, and he grows soybeans and pumpkins. We also cover clinical trial costs, and there are mandated benefits for cancer and other disorders. Delegate Shirley Nathan Pulliam in our House of Delegates introduced and got passed $2.5 million per year for uninsured women under 50 that weren't covered by the CDC program. And this was developed based on data that a partnership with the medical school helped. And then the last piece on this, the bottom of this slide, is Senate Bill 459 from this past legislative session. Again, Senator Middleton, the key sponsor, for Rural Physician Task Force so that we would have better distributions of physicians. Definitions for the students are in your packets, the differences between policy, legislation, and regulation, and I won't go into all those. The 10 significant cancer-related health mandates were brought by survivorship groups, patient advocates, and loved ones of people who did not have access to these resources. House Bill 58 in 2006 started our health disparities report card and telemedicine use and reimbursement. And this is a typical picture at this time of year in Maryland where we have our really good crabs. That little bottle back there is not beer, but it is butter. So our community-initiated prostate cancer program for uninsured men in rural Charles County was developed because of the high morbidity and mortality from prostate cancer being the second most common cancer in men. Racial disparities are very well known, 1.5 times higher incidence in black men, over 2 times higher death rate. The lowest death rate for prostate cancer in the U.S. is for Asian Pacific Islander men. Among men with early prostate cancer who did not get treatment, younger age of diagnosis and higher tumor grade were associated with higher risk of dying. And although the best treatment option for clinically localized disease is unknown, prostate cancer specific survival is higher among men receiving radical prostatectomy compared to watchful waiting. And then the disparities are not simply race. The uninsured men have higher morbidity and mortality. Thank you. African-American men are 26% less likely to receive aggressive therapy, and low-income men are 22 to 40% have a higher mortality rate than the highest income brackets. So this is how our program developed. A community leader, Dr. Dolores Datcher, who was the PI of a Southern Maryland NCI-supported grant, and prostate cancer survivors in Southern Maryland noted that uninsured men were diagnosed at later stages and had higher mortality. They organized a community prostate cancer breakfast to present the data and solicit support from Senator Middleton. He is always responsive to rural and health disparities needs and agreed to introduce the bill. They partnered with the University of Maryland School of Medicine, my office, and our community network program to document clinical and educational needs. This is data-driven advocacy and technical assistance that was followed by a series of hearings and testimony to the House and Senate, leading to the passage of Senate Bill 283. The importance when you're working with legislatures is to track the legislation. So although it passed, there was a budget crisis and the budget was zeroed out. We used our P60 Export Center to provide $80,000 in funds for research and evaluation, and additional funding was provided by the Secretary of the State Health Department and the County Commissioners. The program is administered by the local county public health department, and it's a 3-year program just starting. The sociological framework is a way to sustain and foster ownership by communities. And I can't go into all of this, but there's pieces to this framework in every part of the action leading to the legislation and now the program. At the individual, interpersonal, organizational, community, and societal or policy levels. So to conclude, addressing disparities requires a multifaceted approach that includes research across the continuum, community engagement and capacity enhancement, policy research, and leveraging of funds for sustainability. Our Maryland model always includes policy research to address not only access and quality, but support sustainability. This community-initiated program for prostate cancer demonstrates the role and ownership of affected communities in not only identifying and proposing solutions, but monitoring critical health issues. Policy research coupled with community capacity enhancement led to the development of this program to improve education, screening, early detection, and treatment. I'd like to always acknowledge our funding sources, the Maryland Cigarette Restitution Fund, 2 NCI-supported grants, Special Populations and Community Network, and our NCMHD P60 Center. Further, to acknowledge the leadership of Dr. Dolores Datcher, a leading educator and advocate in Southern Maryland who was the impetus behind bringing these data to the legislature and to the academics. My minority outreach partners, Reverend Dr. DeForge, a prostate cancer survivor, and Jim Anderson. Our special population team, all of my staff, and of course the leadership of Senator Thomas Mack Middleton, who chairs the Senate Finance Committee, the Charles County Health Department, and the Maryland Department of Health and Mental Hygiene. And with that, I look forward during our discussion period to hearing your comments as well as questions. Thank you again.
Thank you so much, Dr. Baquet, for that insight. Post-traumatic stress disorder, or PTSD, is something we usually associate with military combat. Dr. Spero Manson, you've actually been studying PTSD for some time now, and studying PTSD that develops from exposures that American Indian men experience in daily life. Share with us, if you will, your findings and the innovative approaches being developed to alleviate this debilitating condition as it's associated and its associated problems.
Thank you very much, Stephanie. Ani Bojo, in the words of my people, Pemina Chippewa from the Turtle Mountain Reservation, greetings and thank you for the opportunity to be here with you in Chapel Hill as well as across the country. What I'd like to invite you to do is join me briefly over the next 15 minutes in a journey across the experiential landscape with respect to growing up and becoming and being male in American Indian Alaska Native communities, particularly in rural reservation settings. What I'd like to do is provide you with a brief overview of what we've discovered to date in terms of the nature and extent of trauma and particularly post-traumatic stress disorder, a debilitating and chronic illness that frequently follows on the footsteps, on the heels of the experience of a traumatic event. Move to some of the experiences that others have had with respect to the role of traditional healing and the amelioration of the stress and consequences of post-traumatic stress disorder. Turn next to what are some of the unlikely consequences that we often might not consider in terms of risk for other health conditions that are extremely adversive. And lastly, end with a little bit of a story around our use of real-time interactive video conferencing as one mechanism by which we can begin to address the gaps not only in culture but geography with respect to the resources available to these men. Just to begin with a common point of reference, post-traumatic stress disorder, or PTSD as you'll hear me refer to it periodically, is an anxiety disorder that one of us may actually develop after experiencing an extreme, overwhelming traumatic event that is often out of the range of ordinary human experience. Trauma itself is, I think many of us may be aware, is an intensely stressful event during which a person suffers serious harm or perceives the possibility of the threat to himself or to others in terms of death or bodily injury. Some of the kinds of qualifying traumatic events are well known to us, particularly as we review today's media around the world. There are various forms of abuse, whether they be mental, physical, sexual, or otherwise. Catastrophe, particularly the examples from Myanmar and China, come immediately to mind. Violent attacks, assault, battery, domestic violence, and rape, but particularly in American Indian, Alaska Native communities with the plethora of wild dogs and feral animals there, the risk for actual injury and in recent examples, just in the last couple of months in several Native communities, death at the hands of dogs is not uncommon, unfortunately. And then, of course, battle and combat present a series of traumatic events that are unique in their own right. A careful reading of the literature reveals that the traumatic events, which are really central, it's the etiologic nexus of the diagnosis of post-traumatic stress disorder, are not random, that they are not distributed throughout the population in a random-like fashion, but that, in fact, there are patterns to their occurrence, and they carry with them conditional risk of post-traumatic stress disorder. My first entry into this arena came in the context of 1990 in an attempt to understand the extent to which American Indian Vietnam veterans suffered from trauma and post-traumatic stress disorder. You may not, from a number of you in the audience, you're not as old as I am, and may not remember the Vietnam era period, but in the mid-1970s, there was an enormous debate in this country about the nature of the Vietnam experience for our military personnel who served there. First, there was great question about whether or not the notion of post-traumatic stress disorder was real and tangible and could be identified in a systematic and reliable way. And secondly, our Congress was literally split about whether or not experience of combat was a strength-building experience that contributed to the moral fiber of our American men at that point in time, or was, in fact, a very debilitating experience that had enormous consequences that only surfaced upon their return to the United States. Now, as we reflect upon our recent experiences in Iraq and Kuwait and Afghanistan, it seems absurd to us that there would be such a debate. But as recently as 30 years ago, there was enormous debate. And as a consequence, Congress funded a major study called the National Vietnam Veterans Readjustment Study to establish once and for all whether or not there was something reliable and valid called post-traumatic stress disorder, the extent to which this country was prepared to address the needs of those servicemen and women who suffered from it, and whether or not we were adequately equipped to address their needs. The evidence was resounding that, in fact, post-traumatic stress disorder is a reliable and valid diagnosis, that it's highly prevalent among men who experience combat, that the VA and other elements of our health system were poorly equipped to address their needs, and thus began a bolus of funding on the orders of several hundreds of millions of dollars for the white, black, and Hispanic veterans who participated in the study and the subpopulations they represented. But it was with the advocacy of Spark Matsunaga, a Democrat from Hawaii, who acknowledged that other subpopulations of veterans were as in much in need and were not receiving the benefits of those initial congressional appropriations that followed quickly on the heels of the NVVRS study. And so he sponsored a bill that allowed us to undertake a major systematic inquiry into the nature and extent of post-traumatic stress disorder and its consequences among American Indian and Vietnam veterans, as well as those of other subgroups. That study, known as the American Indian Vietnam Veterans Project, took place in two reservation communities that were tribal in nature in the southwest and northern plains. It was rigorous scientifically in all senses. And I'm going to populate my presentation with references so that those of you, particularly at a distance, can refer back to the PowerPoint presentation to follow in greater detail the findings of this particular work. Well, in brief, the American Indian Vietnam Veterans Project, which shows here on this graph the magenta line at the bottom, which is current prevalence, that is within 12 months of interview, and lifetime, that is prevalence of post-traumatic stress disorder, that is within the life as it had transpired up to the point of interview for the Southwest Northern Plains, Hispanic, Black, and Whites, you can see that by and large, at the current, that is the lower line, the magenta line, that the current rate of post-traumatic stress disorder is substantially greater for the American Indian participants in this study compared to the white counterparts, and not between their Hispanic and Black counterparts. But when you look to lifetime, you can see that, in fact, there are enormous disparities in the prevalence of post-traumatic stress disorder, as represented by the yellow line, in which they range from 45 to nearly 68%, more than double those of their white counterparts, and again, 1.5 times greater than their Hispanic and Black counterparts. We were interested in looking at the extent to which a variety of different kinds of resources might be available to these men as they struggled, and their families and their communities struggled with post-traumatic stress disorder. And we looked at the extent to which both biomedical as well as traditional healing resources figured into this picture. And this particular slide shows, for example, the extent to which among the Northern Plains and the Southwest veterans participating in this study sought care for help with alcohol, drug, and mental health problems from biomedical facilities, the Indian Health Service and the Veterans Administration, as well as for problems with physical health problems. You can see here an enormous disparity in terms of the extent to which they were willing to seek help and sought help for physical health problems, but not for alcohol, drug, and mental health problems. We also saw, with respect to traditional healing resources, that kind of discrepancy as well, although less pronounced. And the discrepancy here was more between the two tribal reservation communities, with those in the Southwest seeking those resources much more actively than their Northern Plains counterparts. The really interesting aspect of this is when you combine the traditional healing and the use of biomedical resources, you find virtually equal patterns of help-seeking behavior, underscoring the importance of traditional healing resources to the men in these communities. And it was as a consequence of this study in April of 1998 that the VA signed a memorandum of agreement with the Southwestern tribal community so that from that point on and until today, they actually provide reimbursement for upwards of 13 tribal ceremonies provided on behalf of the men from those communities. With those lessons learned, we recognized that the work in question was actually limited to men and only a particular status, a segment of the community, and we broadened this work to virtually the same communities to include men and women 15 to 55 years in age. It was the American Indian Service Utilization Psychiatric Epidemiology Research Risk and Protective Factors Project, or SUPERFIP, as we came to call it. It was a large-scale project, again, informed diagnostically by the most current scientific methods of the day. It, too, was a population-based sample and using tribal roles in which to identify and draw random sampling of members from the community, and it was conducted nearly a decade ago. Again, this work is well published in a variety of areas, and the first area that we looked at was the extent to which the men and women in this particular study experienced trauma broadly, as I highlighted it at the very outset. And you should know that among the men particularly, and it was substantially greater among men than women, that nearly 70%, that's 7 out of 10 men, noted that they had within their lifetime up to this point had experienced a major qualifying traumatic event. To put that into context, the National Comorbidity Study, at that point in time, the closest national estimates we had from an equally rigorous study across the nation, indicated that about 61% of men reported experiencing a traumatic event. And from a similar study in Australia, it was slightly higher, about 65%. And the difference between the men overall in the U.S. population as represented by the National Comorbidity Study and the SuperFIP study was substantially different. We also then looked at moving from trauma to post-traumatic stress disorder and applying the current diagnostic definitions through these means. We identified that almost 10% of the men who participated in this study qualified for a diagnosis lifetime of post-traumatic stress disorder. This was slightly higher than a study done by Naomi Breslow in inner city Detroit, which was 9.5%. So it equates fairly readily the stress attendant to living in inner city Detroit with living on American Indian reservations that these men lived in. That's again in sharp contrast to the National Comorbidity Study that identified about 5% of men nationally, and in an earlier study, the Epidemiologic Catchment Area Study, about 1% of men. So dramatic differences here. And there are also some consequences to that. We were able to look at the extent to which trauma, particularly early childhood trauma and childhood adversities, contributed to or detracted from parenting, contributed to risk of anxiety and other kinds of disorders, as well as contributed to alcohol disorders. And the results were unequivocal and dramatic. Trauma contributed enormously and differentially by gender to risk of anxiety disorders, depression, as well as pathological parenting. Well, we've taken this work into new lines of inquiry, and that work has basically been looking at the extent to which post-traumatic stress disorder may in fact contribute to other adversive health conditions. We know that post-traumatic stress disorder affects the central autonomic systems in a variety of ways that we don't have an opportunity to go into here today. But suffice it to say that the contributions that it makes to the dysregulation of the HPA axis suggest that, in fact, it ought to contribute to risk of cardiovascular disease. And given the high rates of exposure to trauma and the increasing rates of cardiovascular disease in Indian and Native communities, we suspect that it, in fact, might be a substantial and previously unanticipated contributor. And, in fact, our work has shown that it's an independent and substantial contributor, that is, trauma to cardiovascular disease in Indian men especially. We've also found that trauma is closely linked to pain, and that's a relationship that's verified in our own work. And we know that pain affects help-seeking behavior and adherence to treatment recommendations. So the extent to which there's pain present in the presenting complaints and interferes with the treatment process, it becomes particularly significant for those of us seeking to help our colleagues. And we know that trauma is associated with the onset as well as progression of diabetes, an epidemic disease in American Indian Alaska Native communities. And we've been able to confirm that, in fact, trauma contributes independently and substantially to both the risk of onset as well as severity and the intractability of diabetes in terms of treatment. Well, we've now moved beyond the epidemiologic frame and exploration into these other areas of potential consequences of trauma and PTSD, and are struggling to find ways in which we can begin to get new and important resources to these men in such need. And we've turned to real-time interactive video conferencing as one means for bridging this gap in geography and culture. And we've also been using home-based telecommunication technologies as well to provide a more comprehensive, continuous approaches to care. And so to date, we have a wide spectrum of what we call telehealth and teleeducation partnerships throughout Indian country. And the best example of that is within our post-traumatic stress disorder clinics that are supported by the Veterans Administration Indian Health Service. You know that approximately 60% of these men, and particularly Lakota men, experience post-traumatic stress disorder. But the added thing is that stigma and lack of confidentiality constrain their access to care and their actual utilization of it. And also, too, the resources are a great distance, 180 to 300 miles away, and they have an enormous distrust of the federal government. So through now, literally as I speak, 17 clinics around the country, we offer weekly clinics that provide initial assessment, medication management, individual and group psychotherapy, and use community liaisons such as physician extenders or community health representatives, and employ a variety of different models that that capitalize on the federal, tribal, and state relationships. And this work is well described for you in a variety of publications, underscoring both the cultural acceptability of it, the cost effectiveness of it, as well as the treatment outcomes. So in final analysis, we feel that there's enormous reason, despite the widespread prevalence of trauma and post-traumatic stress disorder, that we can make a difference through new, innovative, and creative mechanisms for bridging these gaps in geography and culture, and that we can begin to treat its consequences. But we hope more, but with this kind of understanding, to get ahead of the curve, to work through a variety of different settings so that we can promote the resiliency and strength that's so much present in Indian and Native communities, to better equip men as well as all members of our communities to better weather and to be less susceptible to the consequences of trauma in the various forms that it may take. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Manson, for that. Dr. Valenzuela, we know that the environment can influence and affect health, and the occupational environment in particular is especially important for men's health. Can you sort of help us get a clearer picture of the ways in which occupations and material deprivations impact the health of Latino men?
Absolutely. Good afternoon. I'm very happy to be here today and to share my work with you. However, before I do that, I really need to provide appropriate thank yous. And I want to lead by thanking Dr. Schoenbach of the School of Public Health and Heather Hunt of the Center for Poverty, Work, and Opportunity. I also want to thank several other key staff who assisted with my stay here in Chapel Hill. And then finally, I need to thank the patrons, the Institute for Public Health at North Carolina A&T State University, and of course the Dean's Office of the University of North Carolina School of Public Health. I'm very grateful for my opportunity to be here. In the brief time allotted to me, I want to talk about a group of workers, about 98%, who are men, and how what they do has important health disparity implications. I'm referring to day laborers, immigrant workers who search on a daily basis for temporary work. For my presentation, I'll first talk about the workers in the day labor market, paying particular attention to health-related disparities, including injuries, violence, stress, and access to care. I'll then discuss an explanatory framework and proffer key interventions. So for those of you who don't know who I'm talking about, these pictures, I think, provide vivid images of men who search in public markets for temporary work. My research on day laborers and this market stems over a decade, using traditional research methods, including surveys, in-depth interviews, non-participant observation, and case studies. During the past 2 years, I've paid particular attention to health-related issues in day labor. In 2004, I directed the first national survey of day laborers, where I traveled to over 25 states, over 150 cities, and almost 300 different hiring sites interviewing day laborers. So what is day labor? Well, it's the search for temporary work in public markets, usually for work in the residential construction industry. The specific market shouldn't be confused with day laborers who are dispatched on a daily basis by temporary staffing agencies or with other types of contingent workers. Looking for work in public spaces is a time-honored tradition in the United States and elsewhere in the world. Indeed, day labor has existed for centuries, dating back to medieval times. In the United States, day laborers can be traced back to at least 1780. Since at least the mid-1800s, shape-up sites in New York and other Northeast ports provided a system of hiring dock workers for the day or half day by seemingly arbitrary selection from a gathering of men. Under the casual labor system, longshoremen seeking work were forced to gather on decks every morning to await the shape-up call from a hiring foreman. They would then form a half circle, and this foreman would select between 6 and 8 men, who then formed a gang, and they were instructed to disload a ship and its cargo, and they were paid at the end of that day. As I'll describe in a few minutes, day labor is difficult and dangerous work, mostly concentrated in the residential construction industry, but also in the hauling, moving, painting, and landscaping occupations. Several colleagues and I have estimated that about 120,000 day laborers nationally exist, either seeking or performing day labor assignments on any given day. They're found in every region of the country, including the Carolinas. As our economy further slips, I expect the number to increase as the ranks of the unemployed seek work in this manner. Finally, day laborers toil under a political climate that is outwardly hostile to newcomers, fueling xenophobic actions, including border vigilantes, anti-immigrant hate groups, and volatile protests, complete with picket signs, U.S. flags, bullhorns, and video surveillance. And they do this at sites where day laborers gather in their search for employment. Who are day laborers? Well, they're predominantly immigrants. 93% of them are recent arrivals, not recent arrivals, but foreign-born. They're Latino. About 80% of all day laborers across the country are from either Mexico or Central America, and they're youthful. Most were born in Mexico, about 60% of them, followed by Central America at about 28%. But the third largest group at 7% are U.S.-born workers. Two-fifths, 40%, have lived in the United States for more than 6 years, and almost 10% had been here more than 20 years. So clearly, some of them have been in this country for a very long time, yet are searching for work in this manner. About a fifth are recently arrived, that is, they've been in this country for less than 1 year. The vast majority of these workers are undocumented. That is, they don't have legal documents to work or to reside in the United States. They're part of the 12 to 14 million undocumented men, women, and children in this country. Clearly, their search for work in this manner signifies an eagerness for employment and their tenacity to do something about their unemployed status. However, as I described with the next slide, working day labor does little to prevent these men from escaping poverty. Day labor is hardly lucrative. Abuses are rampant and the work is sporadic. While the length of any given assignment is short, usually one day, most day laborers string together enough assignments to earn a living, albeit one below the poverty line. Most of them make about $10 an hour or more, but their earnings are constrained by low wages at the bottom of the income distribution and the difficulty of securing consistent daily work, even during the busy summer season. In a good month, their median earnings rise to about $1,400. In a bad run, they fall to about $500. Their annual earnings likely do not exceed $15,000, placing most day laborers among the working poor. Abuses in this market are unfortunately all too common. Hazards and injuries as a result of the dangerous and difficult work are numerous. Finally, the search for work sometimes is contentious, in part because anti-immigrant hate groups undertake deliberate campaigns to discredit and misinform when empirical evidence about these workers and the day labor industry exists. In addition, many communities throughout the United States work and embrace day laborers and the important role that they undertake in the local economy. In other areas, conflict and tensions sometimes emerge. On top of their meager earnings, day laborers regularly suffer employer abuse. Almost half reported at least one instance of wage theft in the 2 months prior to taking my survey. That is, they were either not paid at all at the end of their assignment, or they were paid at an amount less than they had negotiated. 44% were denied food or water breaks, and many are often refused bathroom breaks or abandoned at the workplace without any transportation, often miles away from their home or from the place where they were searching for work. As temporary construction workers, day laborers face an industry known for its high rate of injuries. 1 in 5 day laborers say they have gotten hurt on the job, compared with less than 5% in all private industries and approximately 6% in the construction industry. Day laborers are hired to undertake dangerous jobs where there is little, if any, meaningful enforcement of health and safety laws. My research suggests that language barriers, miscommunication, and lack of training are the primary culprit in explaining their high rates of injuries. Unresolved disagreements can also be a source of injury as employers and workers attempt to resolve their differences, sometimes in conflictual ways. Because consistent work is difficult to obtain at these hiring sites, competition among day laborers is fierce and aggressive and can flare up into violence. Employer-worker relations are also fraught with tension. As I already described, wages are often not fixed and instead negotiated at the hiring site or work site. Work opportunities fluctuate from day to day, and employers often assume correctly that most of the workers, most of the day laborers, are recent arrivals and undocumented. As a result of these and other circumstances, the potential for employer abuse or violence is great and often go unreported. Because most employment of day laborers is in the primarily male construction industry, where deadlines are often overrun, where costs are high, and pressures to keep the bottom line are great, the potential for abuse and violence increases as contractors and workers buckle under pressure over conflict over wages, work effort, deadlines, and other workplace issues. When conflicts are not resolved and a contractor or a day laborer feels harmed, one or the other may resort to violence. For day laborers, who are almost all poor, male, desperate, and with little to lose, not being paid for a day's work is a serious matter. Most day laborers, as the slide shows, are victims, 62% of them, of crime rather than as perpetrators, which is at 38%. And the types of violence revolves over searching for work, but also at the workplace. So now that you know more than you care to about day laborers, what factors help us understand and identify their health disparities? 4 major factors provide a holistic model and include the first, which is working poor. Working and still being poor, meaning that these workers are likely to be malnourished, homeless, down and out, and exposed to harsh conditions and virtually locked out of healthcare like so many other Americans. The mental health of day laborers is also at stake as they undergo depression as a result of their anguish, their stress, pressure, and feeling of hopelessness as they search for work and subsistence. As a result, probabilities increase for alcohol and other substance abuse and mental breakdowns. The third important factor is the lack of access to healthcare, even when serious injuries occur. Of course, this very issue also impacts millions of Americans every day. Finally, as I briefly stated, worker characteristics such as being an immigrant, being male, young, undocumented, and employed in this market increases the possibility of unhealthy behaviors, exposure, and lack of access. I'll conclude my presentation with 3 slides that provide an explanatory framework that lead to clear interventions, at least in my mind, which also include public policy and other types of intervention. So the first has to do with the worker characteristics, and I've already outlined some of the demographic characteristics of day labor. We can intervene by providing human capital investments related to education, related to English acquisition, related to skills development, and that would assist day laborers to transition to formal work. Legal status, a very, very big issue among many immigrant workers throughout the country. This is especially true for day laborers. So obtaining at least a temporary worker permit would allow many of the abuses that unscrupulous employers react to or undertake towards day laborers, that would diminish, I argue. And of course, passing comprehensive immigration reform, a major, major issue in our country, that would certainly lead to a much better outcome for health disparities among day laborers. And then I think a particular emphasis on language, providing English as a second language and other programs that aid assimilation of these workers into the labor market, into homes and neighborhoods. The third model, the third framework, has to do with the workplace regime. And here I argue that we need to pay more attention to workplace safety, and that includes appropriate training of tools, of jobs that are asked to do in the construction industry and in other industries and other occupations that day laborers undertake. And we also have to do basic issues of enforcing occupational safety and health standards that are in our law books in the United States, but unfortunately have very little clout or very little bite with regards to enforcement. Day labor as an occupation is unhealthy. Nevertheless, there are important advocates working with day laborers to improve their lives. So supporting day labor programs at a local community level is another key and important intervention. Also, the creation of a worker center. This is usually a geographic space in a neighborhood where workers and employers come together. This formalizes a relatively informal and chaotic process, and it provides a sense of order, employer accountability, but likewise worker accountability. There's about 64 worker centers across the United States. Lots of debate over cities and municipalities investing, and under the current climate, there's been very little movement towards opening new worker centers. But this is clearly a community issue and one in which worker centers can address community conflicts and concerns. Earnings and payment, enforcing labor laws, basic labor laws would go a long way to improving the lives of day laborers. Also providing access to day laborers to financial institutions, providing driver's licenses, all of these types of interventions that lead to a more normal existence in the United States really have huge and tremendous impacts in improving their lives. And then the last slide. Presents a quick model related to access to health care. And here I'm referring to the working poor, to immigrants, and to our health care system. Clearly, supporting universal health care is important. It's key that we also include the undocumented. It's something that's lost in the debate over our national health care reform. But there are other ways that workers and poor folk can obtain health access, and that's in the support of community clinics and, of course, recognizing different needs among different groups, including immigrants and those without documents. And then finally, we can bring the health care system to many of these sites. And there's lots of examples of mobile homes or mobile trucks, which can provide basic screening and educational forums to day laborers. So we should move towards a model where workers don't necessarily have to go to clinics, but rather we can bring services to the workers themselves. And of course, supporting educational efforts related to health. And so with that, I'll look forward to some of your comments and questions after the next speaker.
Thank you, Dr. Valenzuela. And finally, Dr. Wong, in your research, you actually discuss HIV risks in Asian Pacific Islander men. Would you talk about these risks, some of the barriers to prevention within this population of men, and some interventions that are actually being investigated?
Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity to be here today. And I want to thank the invitations and the planning committee and Molly for showing me about University of North Carolina. It's such a wonderful experience. Of course, I want to thank you, individual in particular, Dr. Doc Brown, my colleague and friends, and also Dr. Vic Schoenenbach, for being so good about sending me email 3 o'clock in the morning. And it's great to be here, and I hope I do justice to the spirits of this summit and video conference. I'm going to talk today on HIV prevention about Asian men having sex with men. And this is my outline, and I would give everyone a basic descriptions about the epidemiology and some of the risk profile of Asian MSM, and also I will briefly touch upon intervention strategy and addressing research need. But before we do that, I think it is important for me to give at least 1 minute descriptions of the term Asian and Pacific Islander, because I think it's important to set the context. Wait a minute. Oh God, so I guess my assistant didn't really do the work I asked her to do it. It's flashing. Okay, anyway, I don't think this slide would do justice to the term Asian and Pacific Islander, because this term is designed and come up by a US federal agency called the Management and Office of Management and Budget. It's called Directive 15. For those of you who have an interest in how we in this country talk about race ethnicity, please go and read up Directive 15, because it's extremely informative how we end up using this racial classification for a number of reasons, how we use it as a proxy for health, for congressional redistricting and other things. API as the terminology include over 40 cultural groups and over 100 languages. And you have like individual, like my friend Steve Liu, live in San Francisco, is fifth generation Chinese. And then you have like individuals who recently come from, they're Hmong people, and they're distant related to Chinese. And for those of you that are anthropologists in the crowd, you know that Hmong individuals, they didn't even have their written language until 1956. It was invented for them by an anthropologist, William Smalley. They are oral people. So you think about the diversity, it's staggering. Nonetheless, 70% of us are foreign born, and we come from like Philippines, China, and Vietnam. Even the term Chinese, I'm raised culturally Chinese, but Chinese, according to our federal government, is you have to be from mainland China. Okay, so roughly 4.1% of us are in US in 2004. Okay. 81% of the API in 2005 were diagnosed were men. And a majority of the API diagnosed with AIDS are 61, like majority of them are foreign born. So it kind of like matched the population statistics. We have very low HIV testing rate, and we're not different from any other racial ethnic group. Like we practice like risky behavior. In one particular study in Sahat, Seattle, even though majority of the API said that okay, 90% say like they themselves are at risk, but only 47% have ever been tested. Okay, very low testing rate. And for those in one of the percent, this is a CDC numbers. In 2004. API that receive a diagnosis, 44% of them receive an AIDS diagnosis within 1 year of getting HIV diagnosis. So what it means is like by the time they found out, probably it's so late into the process, so they immediately become sicker than the other and the other group. So obviously testing is a major component. If we can catch people earlier, we can treat them earlier. Okay. In one of my own study, this is based on a CDC data set that I use. In that particular data set, I look at HIV testing awareness, and I believe the number is roughly 46%. 46% of the sample have ever been tested the first time when they show up in the hospital. Okay, so that means like they have symptoms. They go to hospital. Then they find out they have HIV. And oftentimes AIDS at that time. Okay. 61% of the API with HIV are men, men having sex with men. Although this is a men's conference, men's health disparity, think about it, men having sex with men is about behavior. What does it mean in relation to the other gender? Okay, so just think into broader terms. Okay. Collectively, the cumulative A cases among API is 72%, is the highest among all racial ethnic groups proportionally, okay, other than white. Although the absolute number is still small, but if you don't get tested, you don't get captured. So the next few slides, I'm going to talk about some other statistics in San Francisco. Okay, other than the state of Hawaii, San Francisco probably has the highest concentration of Asian Pacific Islander. The city of San Francisco estimated has over 30% of its citizens, residents self-identify as API. So the HIV prevalence rate is nearly 3%, 10% of them are among Thai MSM. 47% report having had unprotected anal intercourse in the past 6 months. Okay, I don't care what people say about API, a modern minority, we use drugs, just like anybody else. 63% use illicit drugs, and 34% has sex under the influence of illicit drug in the past 6 months. Okay, so in 1999 to 2002, this is a series of study done by a number of colleagues in San Francisco. If you look at the rate change in terms of HIV sero status, it jumped from 6 to 16%. Okay, the incident of rectal gonorrhea, when these are all markers of getting HIV, also increased from 200 to 800 per 100,000. So clearly, there's a number of things that potentially put API-MSM at risk for HIV. This is one of my own studies funded by National Institute of Drug Abuse. I just wrapping up the study. This is a study in DC, and it's a cross-sectional behavioral study. For those that people that have self-report ever been tested in the US, this particular study, I didn't do any HIV testing, so I'm just asking like for a self-report. 4.2% has tested positive. The challenges, obviously, is I don't think it's unique to API, but certainly it magnified. Like when it comes to like certain culture, sex and drugs are difficult to talk. It's stigmatized, and being gay is stigmatized. And also in some API culture, there's really no construct of what exactly is gay. Okay, so being gay is a very American term, and so the effect of migration experience. Remember, majority of us are foreign born. So when you move into this country, you bring a whole new set of culture, but as you making the adjustment to the to this culture, things shift, okay? We do know for one thing, it's based on the Latino literature, that the longer you stay here, the more you pick up all the bad American thing, if there is such a thing. So, all right, let me talk a little bit about intervention. We don't have a lot of study on intervention. Majority of the intervention that I'm going to present here are non-published, which is really unfortunate. This one, the first one, is published. It's by Kyung-hee Choi, my colleague at UCSF at CAPS. It's a three-hour group counseling session in culturally appropriate setting with 329 self-identified homosexual API. And they look at four components. Kyung-hee like focus on four components: develop positive self-identity and social support, education for safer sex, eroticizing safer sex, negotiate for safer sex. And this study was published long ago, so I wonder to what extent it still holds up in terms of its generalizability today. It's a little bit unclear. The number of partners decreased for those that enroll in the study. Thank you. The number of partners decreased by 46% at 3 months. Chinese and Filipino men reduced and protected intercourse by more than half. And there potentially is a self-selection bias because Filipino and Chinese are the largest sub-ethnic group in Bay Area, so in San Francisco. This is a single session small group study done by Don Operaro, and who's currently, I think, on his way, moving back from Oxford to United States. He provides social support, increased ethnicity, and all the same construct that Kyung-hee has focused on, enhanced safer sex negotiations, and dual identity, so on and so forth. I'm not so clear whether this is published or not. As far as I'm concerned, Kyung-hee is the only one that has published her intervention study, which is in the previous slide. Oh, okay. I made a mistake. This particular study, I was involved in 1996 to 2000, this is a study funded by HRSA, Health Resource Service Administration. It's a five-year intervention study targeting HIV-positive Asian and Pacific Islander in New York City. So this is more like a surface program study, but has a strong evaluation component. So my colleague and I actually have published a series of paper in it. We focus in particular undocumented Asian and monolingual or limited English-speaking Asian in New York City. So it's really not a scientific study, but rather to ensure this individual continue to practice safer sex, have access to appropriate treatment and appropriate care, and to make sure that they can talk, be able to relate to their caretaker in a positive way. Now, intervention four is done by Dr. Toronomoto in California. It's focusing on young people, 18 to 24, and using a combination of intervention strategy, focus group, and also like group session. And this study, I was involved in the very beginning. It was like very, very difficult in part is initially, because we have this whole concept of this weekend retreat, what have you, and people in San Francisco said, no, I don't want to come to weekend retreat. So like you're trying to find the format that like really make people want to come to the retreat. So you have the whole, you have to think about like social marketing, and we as scientists oftentimes forgot about that piece. We just think that we have this great knowledge, they must listen. It didn't work that way, okay? So we still don't know a lot about API MSM, in particular because majority of the people are foreign-born, so it's important that we need a little bit more information. And I don't need to say about intervention, because if we don't even have the basic epidemiology, intervention becomes much more difficult to do. So I have a five-year NIH-funded study right now, and these are the goals and objectives funded by NIH, is to get the basic prevalence and some of the behavioral information. So this is a testing study. In total of five cities, Boston, Los Angeles, Philadelphia, New York, and San Francisco. And we also work with a total of eight national partners. We're going to test 2,400 API MSM. We want to particularly focus on certain ethnic group based on our census, but anybody who self-identifies as API and as an MSM will be eligible to enroll. And these are the technology we use: oral quick, Western blot, behavioral survey, and also the respondent-driven sampling and value base. And one cannot talk about APMSM in this country without understanding the bridge between here and back in Asia. And Asia is now with an epidemic that hopefully we can learn from the lesson in Africa, that Asia doesn't become another Africa. Okay, as you can tell from the slide, there's all this like traffic back and forth. Majority of the individuals are foreign born. Although what you can come into this country as a legal immigrant, and obviously you have to be negative, once you come in, there's no way of stopping you from going back and forth and engaging in risk behavior. The surveillance system is so passive, so it is really difficult to really capture that. So in basic recommendation is that we need early testing, we need more model intervention. We also need certain types of methodology that are appropriate for small sample size. For small sample population, that API, we cluster in three areas: Hawaii, California, and New York. Okay, and even that, there is great diversity. Okay, and I look forward to your questions. These are references. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that information, Dr. Wong. So we see that there are a wide array of factors that affect the health of men, and that men of color experience too many factors with adverse effects. How can we make the balance more positive? How can we counteract the adverse impact of those factors that we cannot change quickly? In just a few minutes, you're going to have an opportunity to dig into the layers of this issue with our guests here in the auditorium by calling 1-877 869-7811. If you're here in the auditorium, you have an opportunity to ask questions at our microphones. You can also submit a web form at www.minority.unc.edu/questions or send us email at questions@unc.edu. Don't go away. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the discussion portion of our program. If you have a question, we have a number of ways for you to be heard. If you are here in our auditorium, please come to one of the microphones set up in our aisleways. If you are joining us via satellite, feel free to give us a call at 1-877-869-7811 or submit the web form at www.minority.unc.edu/questions. And finally, you can also send us email to questions@unc.edu. Remember, we want as many people as possible to get their questions answered or comments heard, so please be brief. Now, we are going to take a call. That's going to be our first question. Caller, if you could state your name, tell us where you're from, and give us your question.
Hello?
Hello. Hi.
Hello.
Can you tell us where you're from?
Yes, I'm from Richmond, Virginia, and I attend Virginia Commonwealth University.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for your call. Who's your question directed toward, and if you can go ahead and ask your question?
My question is directed toward Dr. Wong. And basically, we wanted to know if he could go into further detail what he meant by the statement when he mentioned that he didn't want Asia to be another Africa in relation to the spread of HIV and AIDS.
Well, is it on?
It should be on, yes.
Oh, it's on. Okay. What I'm trying to say is that at least there are part of Asia are still very early in the epidemic. We should do everything in our power to like emphasize on the prevention work. We, like, for example, if you look at Thailand, Thailand have this 100% condom. I mean, it was able to, for the longest time, hold the prevalence and the incident down. So government needs to talk openly about sex, right? Condom use. And you don't want to make the mistake in the sense that you have, whether I agree or disagree, you do not want to be in a position such as like, and Baquet keeps saying that it's not an issue, right? Because when political leaders are willing to come forward and make a case, things do change. So I really would like the Asian country leader to really stand up and have the political will and say something.
All right.
This is not a disease that affects just certain types of people.
All right. We are going to take an email question, and this is from a Dr. Anita Hawkins. Her question reads, the data suggests that minority men who are employed and insured still suffer from health disparities and are less likely than their white counterparts to avail themselves of health care services. Has anyone explored workplace policies and culture as barriers to appropriate health care utilization? And I guess anyone can pick that up. Any thoughts?
I'll try to take a stab at this question. Obviously, cultural barriers at a very basic level, for example, gender, men frequent doctors much less than do women. When you add complexities as a result of being a foreigner, as a result of not having documents, as a result of not being able to speak fluently in English, or being able to communicate even in broken English about a particular disease, really leads to a breakdown in men being able to receive care. I don't know of research that looks at some of these specific nuances, cultural nuances and differences, but I imagine that their literature is pretty rich in this area because we know that there are cultural nuances, differences among African Americans, where the literature is much more rich in comparison to Asian-American men, for example, or Latino American men as well. So I imagine that literature does exist. I just don't know where and who has published it.
Okay. Other thoughts?
The role of social class and its interaction with race or ethnicity is gathering more attention. For example, we are starting to look in Maryland at African Americans who are middle income or higher, women and men, and their health care-seeking behaviors, which may have been formed not at their current income or educational level, but during their childhood. And that the socioeconomic status of childhood forms health-seeking behaviors and risk patterns that individuals carry into adulthood, regardless of whether or not they are employed. We're looking at that as a hypothesis to explain the rate of advanced cancer diagnosis, breast, and prostate in African Americans who do have insurance or are middle and upper income. We know that even African Americans who have a higher income have a poorer cancer survival than low-income whites. So there's something about culture, there's something about the intersection of race, ethnicity, that's formed during one's early years that people take into adulthood, and that's something we're starting to look at.
Dr. Manson?
I think one of the major points of concern ought to be with stigma. And for example, in American Indian and Native communities, alcoholism has been a major problem for decades. And it was as recently as 25 years ago that it was a matter of shame and embarrassment to acknowledge being alcoholic. We had a number of courageous leaders step forward, men and women, to acknowledge alcoholism and the impact that it's had in their lives. And today, we find relatively little stigma attached to alcoholism, and it's made it much easier to deal with, and it certainly encourages others to come forward and seek help. I wish I could say the same was true for mental illness, but it's certainly not. We today, with respect to mental illness in American Indian Native communities, are where we were at 40 years ago with respect to alcoholism. And I'll never forget interviewing an American Indian Vietnam veteran who said, look, the mental health program is in a trailer to the side of the major hospital, and if I walk to that trailer, everybody will know what the nature of my problem is. And he said, I'd rather be thought drunk than crazy. And I think that's one of the major issues for us, regardless of the disease, with respect to cancer or other kinds of things. I think there are these stigmas and shame surrounding them, and they are different by group and different by gender. But we have an enormous amount of work to do in terms of making an impact in that regard.
Okay, thank you. Sir, you have a question?
Yes, to Dr. Manson. My name is Flavio Rojas. I'm a postdoc in biostatistics, trained as a sociologist with a PhD in that wonderful university in Durham. I won't say the name. I'm doing research on indigenous peoples in Chile, in the southern part of Chile. I was very happy to and struck to hear Dr. Manson's presentation on, and they're very coincidence. The findings are very similar, if you could say the psychiatric part, and the outcomes and violence, injuries among indigenous peoples in Chile is one of the third leading factors of going to the hospitals, fights, and of course also alcoholism, and certainly the relationship with material deprivation and very bad socioeconomic factors. My question has to do with the other side, when these communities become prosperous or wealthy. We know, for instance, the system of casinos. And indigenous reservations in the United States. That also has triggered a lot of anxieties and a lot of psychiatric problems, alcoholisms, drugs, and so on. The question is basically to comment on when affluent or when money comes in and there's in the casino system, or if he has an experience on testing, and see how does it goes when, I mean, you presented poverty, and now what happens when money and income and material goods come into the reservation system? Thank you.
I knew I had arrived professionally about 10 years ago when the X-Files producers contacted me about a scenario that they were developing that had a reservation-based community with a casino about to be introduced. And of course, in Native communities, there are progressive and traditionalists, sort of crudely put, that are on either side of these issues. And the notion of the Wendigo, an ice beast from the north, common to the Eastern Woodlands people, of which I'm a part, was introduced seeking vengeance for the introduction of the casino into the community. So a wholly different kind of trauma, I'm sure your question didn't anticipate. But there are traumas that come along with affluence. It's not as if everybody benefits, much less benefits equally, from these new sources of revenue and what's generated. They also introduce a very different tone to the discourse in these communities about how life ought to be lived, what values the community adheres to, that in many respects reflects accurately the tension that that X-File scene was attempting to explore. And so the other thing that many other things happen, not the least of which is when these communities embed so much hope into the what will come of these casinos, but you arrive at a community like mine and 6 miles south of the Canadian border in north central North Dakota, I mean, goodness sakes, nobody did any social marketing there, Frank, to figure out who would come and spend their money. Well, the problem is that those who are already impoverished become addicted and spend what little resources they have with enormous rippling consequences. So I think there are individual, familial, community, and population-wide consequences that adhere to both what we would automatically assume to be the potential benefits of affluence as well as poverty. So I think there are many issues around that, not the least of which is the disruption of the coherence of the community, the introduction of drinking and driving that frequently adheres to that, and the often failed promises that these economic enterprises initially tout as the rationale for engaging in them. So I think we could talk very productively about both sides of the coin.
Thank you so much. We're going to take a phone call. I believe this one is from Pennsylvania. Caller, if you can state your name, where you're from, and give us your question.
Good afternoon. My name is Jim Williams from Camp Hill, Pennsylvania, South Central Pennsylvania. Chair-elect of the Interculture Cancer Council, and Dr. Baquet is one of our viable members to that board. My question is around the area of social marketing that Dr. Wong spoke of. Hit a nerve when he said that, because it's so true in that, unfortunately, many of the people, especially when we talk about men and prostate cancer, many of the men that we want to get in contact with don't have health on their radar screens. And so many times we create the same programs, we go in the same communities, and we have the same poor attendance. And I was wondering whether there is a discipline such as social marketing, and are there any of the panel members aware of research in this area? Because it's so important that we get people focused on health in America, especially in minority communities. And many times, because we don't understand the social aspects of it, they're not drawn to the great programs that we have available to them.
Anyone want to take that one first?
Well, I don't do social marketing research, but I appreciate the significant and important, because you can have the most brilliant idea, but if you cannot get your idea across, it's useless. And Einstein doesn't become who he is because he was able to get his idea across, because he was able to convince the president or have you. So same with health. We have to find a way people understand health as we scientists understand it. So I always listen to my subjects, or my participant, or my staff. For example, I have also worked in China, and I have my questionnaire basically read through so many times by my participant, pilot test so many times, that I actually understand the nuance. But that is one thing to do a scientific work, because it's still very controlled. You can control that. But when you want to do social marketing on a mass scale, how to get people to go to see your doctor once a year, how would you do that? Just basic things.
Other thoughts? Social marketing?
When I released my study in 2004, I spent a lot of time thinking about its release and how it might impact public discourse. And I was more concerned about the public discourse as opposed to, say, the workers themselves and what they would think about my findings, though I clearly worked with several community-based organizations. And so we vetted the findings, they reviewed a first draft of the report, we discussed whether or not to release certain controversial data. We released all of the data, the controversial one and the less controversial one. And it was interesting because newspapers really captured and portrayed a much different spin, a much different picture of day laborers. And so me and my colleagues and I were very pleased that we were able to at least control for, I say, about a week, how day laborers are discussed in the popular image. And it required a lot of work. It requires writing for a different audience. It requires patience, because your agenda as a researcher is likely very different from the agenda of a community-based organization. It also, you might be accused of being over-politicized with your work, and so there are those who might criticize your work for that. The point that I'm trying to make is that I think it's key to do this type of social marketing, this type of engagement in public discourse, because it does influence how people think, and it influences policymakers and others who want to intervene. And so it's important to engage. It just requires a lot of work and a much different audience and a different skill set.
Let me shift topics just a little bit. We have a question here from UNC School of Public Health. This question addresses or talks about the influence of incarceration in men's health, especially the health of black men. And so just wondering if anybody has any thoughts as it pertains to your population set specifically, or specifically to African American men. If you've seen literature, if you have any thoughts about that and how it impacts men's health.
Just some thoughts and comments from Maryland. There's increasing attention on particularly black incarcerated individuals, not only with the quality of access to healthcare within Maryland's prison system, but also once people are released from prison, and the inability to be able to find jobs, access the healthcare system, not having the tools set up in place when one is released from the prison system. And some of the solutions that are being developed in Maryland, they're not final yet. It's an early discussion, are from members of the Black Caucus in the state legislature. But anyway, it's a significant issue. It's a significant issue from the standpoint of not just health, but contributions to society, absence of men in the home when they're small children or children as they grow up. So it has really broad ramifications.
I have a slight thing to add. One is that there's a distinction between jails and lockups, the equivalent of like the sheriff or county offices, and prisons, longer term incarceration. The issue, although many American Indian men are overrepresented in states like South Dakota, Montana, New Mexico, Arizona, et cetera, in the prison populations, the vast majority of American Indian men have an experience with local jailing and lockup. Now, the issue is about 70% of those jailings and lockups are associated with alcohol use and abuse. And for us, American Indian men, the issue is the risk of suicide within the first 24 to 36 hours of having been jailed in lockup. And there is virtually no surveillance system or preventive intervention that has been systematically introduced into these settings to reduce that risk. And it's one of the major areas of concern that we have with respect to jails and lockups in American Indian and Alaska Native communities.
There is a question also for you, Dr. Manson. This question is from Mitchell Wharton, a doctoral student at the University of Rochester. The question is, does the program that you referenced in your presentation, does the program utilize psychiatric nurse practitioners at all?
We do. Actually, one of the clinicians, the model is that the providers, the clinicians, are located in Denver and using real-time interactive video conferencing extended out 500 to 1,500 miles to distant rural communities. And one of the clinicians is a psychiatric nurse practitioner working as a part of a team with four other psychiatrists and two other clinical psychologists. And she's female, at working with almost exclusively a male population, and works quite well. One of the important things is it's not only just with a provider patient, we also involve families, and she's probably the most effective of all the providers in reaching the family members and partners of these men in terms of enabling them to anticipate and cope with the problems presented by their husbands and brothers and sons.
And then, Dr. Valenzuela, I wanted to ask you, I mean, certainly with the area that you're studying, it's understudied, day laborers. Are we, you talked a little bit about some of the things that you hope can be done, some solutions. Are we moving in the right direction, you think? Are we moving in a direction?
Times, I think, are very difficult for immigrants in this country, especially those without documents. The country's unwilling to tackle a very complicated issue. Complex, and also, I argue, very simple. The fact is we have 12 to 14 million men, women, and children in this country working, providing taxes, going to school, utilizing health services, living among us on a daily basis. And at current, there is no path to their normalization. As a result, not only do they occupy a status as a minority group, but it's one that's even worse than that, right? Because they don't have documents. They're unable to obtain licenses to drive, which means they're unable to go shopping or to pick up their children or to go visit a doctor's office. Many of them can't open bank accounts, which means when they do work, they want to get paid in cash, and they're an easy target for violence. And so I think we need to bring immigration reform and comprehensive immigration reform back into the table. It's a very volatile issue, as the past 2 years have experienced, but it's one that hasn't been resolved. And at this point, I'm not convinced, even if we elect a Democrat, that immigration reform will be tackled. It's just too controversial. And so I don't think we're going in the right direction, though we should be.
Okay, thank you. If you can state your name, where you're from, keep your question very, very tight. That would be great. Thank you.
Katia, my name is Katia Roy-Bird. I work at Lineberger Cancer Center. But I guess maybe you can choose. I had a really quick question for Dr. Manson. If you can give some examples of what you mean by trauma, because the studies you cited were from the Vietnam War, but obviously people are currently experiencing trauma, but I didn't understand if there were examples. And then for Dr. Valenzuela, if we don't have time, I guess you won't answer, but I saw there's a PBS series on health disparities, and they were talking about the negative effects of assimilation, negative health effects, but one of your examples, your paths, your various arrows, we're talking about learn the language, ESL, move to assimilation. So you could address that dichotomy.
Actually, mine are very quickly answered. About the third or fourth slide in gave a list of six different categories of trauma with examples thereof. Was that the basic question? There was a two-part to it.
No, I just might have missed the slide. Thank you.
The dichotomy between this push towards assimilation as opposed to maintaining one's ethnic norms. I oftentimes get into debates, into discussions about exactly what I mean, and part of my argument is basic incorporation, basic settlement activities in neighborhoods and schools, access to health, learning worker rights, civil rights, human rights, and laws that are in place to protect recent arrivals. I also push for integration into labor markets that provide a better living standards, right? And there's data, and it's mixed in terms of health outcomes. And so one part of the debate argues that when you assimilate, you also undertake bad habits that many Americans have, as opposed to not assimilating and thus not getting these types of bad habits or avoiding these types of bad habits. The best that I can say is that the data is not conclusive. It is a debate, and I think that there are some habits that can be avoided, and we can do that through, I think, typical intervention methods related to education, schooling. We must, of course, avoid things that impact our health, like smoking and drinking. But I think a call for not assimilating and not integrating into our society is one that doesn't make a whole lot of sense, at least not in terms of my own research, sociological and planning and otherwise.
Hi, my name is Sloan Sanford. I'm here with the Emerging Leaders in Public Health Program. My question is for Dr. Valenzuela. Could you speak to, I guess, the balance to provide day laborers who are currently in the country with to address their health concerns? Could you speak to balancing that with almost incentivizing a further influx of undocumented people? I think, well, that's it.
I think I understand the question right. The argument is usually framed that increased immigration to this country is a result of all these wonderful opportunities. And so if we invest either through different programs with the undocumented population, it's going to perhaps incentivize, open the doors for other undocumented immigrants from across the world to come to our country. Very, very little evidence that immigrants come to this country to look for work on street corners or to be unemployed for such long periods. There's also very little evidence, mostly written by economists, that they come to this country to participate, for example, in our welfare system or to participate in our healthcare system. Nevertheless, we know that in local communities and in regions, there does seem to be a strain on healthcare services and on our educational system. The problem is that oftentimes the contributions of immigrants in terms of taxes is realized at the federal level. And so services are paid at the local level, and so there is a disconnect. But if you were to aggregate the contributions of immigrants at the national level, it's a positive effect. When you start looking at local context, that's where you do get some disparities. And so one clear way to remedy that, if you will, gap, is for the feds, as a result of not passing immigration reform, to at least compensate, reimburse cities who are trying to grapple with accommodating and welcoming and integrating new arrivals. But that's something that's not done, and it's clearly a discussion that has taken place at the federal level, but one that many of our elected officials fail to address. But that is a proposal that has been put forth in the past, that the federal government should reimburse local communities for not integrating, for the services that they expend on their behalf.
One last question I just want to ask each of you, 30 seconds or less, any final thoughts?
In addressing health disparities, it takes a comprehensive approach that includes multiple components, not just simply intervention, but data, research guiding interventions. The essential piece for making interventions work is community engagement. So that requires a lot of training in academia on being humility and humble and sharing resources with the community. So that's essential.
Dr. Manson.
I think the biggest challenge facing us today with respect to health disparities is to figure out the social marketing of it and consistent messaging of what it's about. I take, for example, the notion of global health, which has come much later, actually, on the heels of health disparities, and think about how effective we have been in terms of enabling everybody in this country to appreciate that they have a stake with respect to the health of people globally. We have not been able to do that successfully with respect to health disparities, whether it's because it's been rooted historically in racial and ethnic context, I don't know. But I do submit to you that we have an enormously important task before us in figuring out how to communicate what health disparities are about and why it should be of concern to everyone.
Dr. Valenzuela.
Our country has a long and storied history of compassion and generosity towards new arrivals. Our country was built on the hands of slaves and on new arrivals to this country. And we've lost that compassion, I think, in the current wave. And I think that we need to revert back to this compassion to resolve some of these vexing and complicated problems. There are some very easy solutions and there are some more difficult ones, but I think we have the knowledge and we have the creativity, and we need to challenge that in a way that's thoughtful and that incorporates these new arrivals. We're not going to deport 12 to 14 million people back to Mexico and Central America. Therefore, we need to think about how we can integrate them in our society so that they can likewise contribute to the greatness of what is our country.
Dr. Wong?
I want to echo my esteemed colleague, Dr. Manson, and also Abel here. The global economy is really shaping things in a different way right now. If you think about Philippines as a country, Philippines export the largest number of overseas workers. Okay, so they come over to the United States, they work, they might not be day laborer, they might not be illegal Asian immigrant residents, what have you, but they're here. So this whole health disparity has become much more complex and convoluted. And as we interface more closely with other economy, God forbid if China starts to sell all our war bond, we would be in deep doo-doo. So health disparity has to have a much more global context to address some of these issues. And one last thing, social marketing. There are certain things that I think the Chinese government is doing wonderful. They mandate that most of the hotel right now, there's condoms. There's like basic risk information. That is a legitimized legal social marketing. You start to normalize the conversation. People start to think of an issue, that HIV is an issue. But unfortunately, it would be very difficult to do in our home country.
All right. Thank you so much. We often talk about women's health, but today our guests took us to another level of understanding regarding the health issues that face men. We looked at the factors that affect men's health, and we identified areas in need of further research and interventional strategies. Unfortunately, though, we are out of time. A big thank you to our guests for their expertise and insight into today's topic. Doctors Claudia Baquet, Spero Manson, Abel Valenzuela Jr., and Frank Wong. Thank you so very much. We'd also like to thank each of our sponsors for helping us to make this event possible. And we hope to show you a list of names on the video conference website after today's broadcast. And finally, we'd like to thank each of you, our viewing audience, for making this video conference a huge success. Be sure to tell your friends and colleagues that they can actually view this broadcast on our website starting tomorrow. And be sure to send us your feedback by using the evaluation form from your site facilitator or submitting the one online at www.minority.unc.edu. Your support is essential for continuing these programs. We look forward to seeing you, each and every one of you, again here next year at the 15th Annual Summer Public Health Research Video Conference on Minority Health. Until then, make it a healthy and safe year.